Ms. Nicholas?
Here.
Mr. Les?
Here.
Ms. Crary?
Here.
Mr. Smalls?
Here.
President Ricks?
Here. Thank you. We'll have number five on our agenda, the approval of minutes of the 39th meeting of the Mayor and City Council dated September the 28th of 15. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Thank you. Madam Clerk?
Mr. Les?
Yes.
Ms. Crary?
Yes.
Ms. Nicholas?
Yes.
Mr. Smalls?
I vote yes.
President Ricks?
Yes. Report of the Mayor and City Council, Ms. Nicholas.
Thank you. On October 17th, I, along with my council colleagues, attended the 30th annual Jim McKay Maryland Million Day, which was well attended. I also attended the principal breakfast on October the 20th that was here at City Hall. And I'd like to wish everyone a happy Halloween.
Thank you. Mr. Les?
Thank you, Mr. President. The most of the council was in attendance at the principal's breakfast. We had some good discussion. We also had our representative on the school board, Ms. Epps, was here. She had to listen to me talk to about the lack of left-handed tools for our elementary school children in the elementary schools. They don't provide tools, left-handed scissors, left-handed rulers. And it's very sad because those kids are at a disadvantage to start with when they're left-handed. But she took it under advisement, so that was good. On the 21st, we had a meeting here at City Hall. We had a good turnout from some of our residents in the Grove to talk about quality of life issues. On the 22nd, we had Secretary Van Mitchell at City Hall. He's the Secretary of Health and Mental Hygiene. We had a good discussion about the Laurel Regional Hospital. And that night, we had the candidates forum. Pretty good turnout. I was sitting on that side for a change. And but I got a chance to listen to all the candidates. And the last few days, we've been down in Cambridge, Maryland, at the Maryland Municipal League Legislative Conference. Well attended. I'll let President Ricks talk about the award we won down there. But the interesting thing at that conference is I see a lot more sessions that deal with real issues at that conference for the municipalities in the state of Maryland. There's 157 of us. And also we talk about the legislative initiatives that will be presented to the Maryland legislature when they go into session in 2016. Please be mindful when driving through your neighborhoods this week by watching out for very excited children out and about for trick-or-treat. Don't forget to turn, you'll get an extra hour of sleep after trick-or-treat. You can turn the clocks back. And that concludes my report, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Les. Ms. Crary?
Thank you, Mr. President. In addition to the previously mentioned events, I also attended the Spooktacular. Congratulations to all the participants this past weekend. They were all winners as far as we're concerned. Thursday night, tomorrow night, will be Halloween on Main Street, sponsored by many departments in town, but especially the local police department. And I want everyone to be careful because it's darker earlier and it may be raining. So the children are excited. They may not be in well-lit costumes. Additionally, on a sad note, we'd like to send our condolences to the family of Mark Freeman and also our condolences to Bubba and the loss of his brother. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Smalls.
Thank you, Mr. President. In addition to the events and activities my colleagues and I participated in, we also attended the 113th annual banquet for our Laurel Volunteer Fire Department. And I'd like to, among the award recipients, congratulate Captain Leiser for the Firefighter of the Year Award and my good friend Mike Selner, who received the President's Award. I'd also like to extend my condolences to the Freeman family, as well as, and it's unfortunate that many of us don't know him by anything other than Bubba, but Bubba and the loss of his brother. That's my report, Mr. President. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smalls. I also, too, want to send my condolences to the Freeman family it's such a shock to found that one of our own like that has been lost at such a young age. I'd like to remind everyone that this coming Tuesday, November the 3rd, is Election Day here in the city of Laurel, that we're hoping that even though it may be a little bit rainy, we're hoping we're still going to have a good turnout. It's important that we see what the citizens want us to do in the future months and years to come and who their representatives will be. I want to remind everyone that the early polling will take place on Saturday before the 31st and from 8 to 5. Is that right, Mrs. Rowe?
Correct.
Okay, thank you very much. So if you need any more information on voting here in the city during this critical time, please contact Ms. Rao in the clerk's office this week. Thank you. At this particular time, I'd like to introduce to the council the Honorable Nick Roan, who is a Chancellor Commander of the Knights of Pythias. Mr. Roan, welcome.
Billy, turn that around and turn it on the microphone. Push the button, it'll go green. There you go.
I'm Nick Rowan, the Chancellor Commander of Fraternal Lodge, Knights of Pythias. On behalf of our lodge, I would like to thank the president and the city council members for joining us and giving us an opportunity to present an outstanding citizens award. We feel that this recipient has devoted his career and his skills to better mankind. Let us now meet the person who dedicated their life to serve the community of Laurel. Master at Arms, would you please escort our recipient to the podium? Ladies and gentlemen, I now present to you the outstanding citizen of Laurel, Dr. Felix Flores. At this moment, I would like to ask our Vice Chancellor Commander, Brother Giles Mills, to the podium.
Members, I'd like to give us the opportunity to read a little bit about what Dr. President Laurel.
It's our pleasure, sir.
In the meantime, I'm going to bring you up to that time on things that he has accomplished and the roadblocks that he has overcome to get to that point. With your permission, sir, I would like to briefly outline your journey to becoming not a good surgeon, but an excellent surgeon. You were born April 25th, 1924, in Tampico, Mexico, which at that time was a very poor community, and they had no paved streets, according to you. They had the old wooden sidewalks like they do in the old days. When you were 9 years old, a major storm hit your area. If you remember correctly, your family went to live in the powerhouse with your where your father worked. At age 12, you went to live with your aunt and uncle and cousins in Monterrey, Mexico. It was here you went to technical school and was expelled when you were 13. Now, you may or may not want to explain that, but I suggest that you might want to explain it. From here, you went to vocational school, which is our equivalent to high school in Tampico. Here you studied violin for 3 years at the Conservatory of Music of Tampico, right? You were second violin. But at the age of 16, you had to give it up when you went to vocational school, which was our college level, at the Polytechnical Institute in Mexico City, where you studied biology. It was then you decided to become a doctor. After finishing the biology course, you went to a medical school at the University of Mexico. For the first 2 years, your lack of money didn't allow you to buy books and everything, so your GPA wasn't the greatest at the time. But then your luck turned, and you were able to get a job as a salesman for a pharmaceutical company. Then you were able to buy books, and your GPA came up. In 1949, you bought your first car, a 1938 Ford Coupe, for $300. Now, the only problem I had with this doc is I have found no record of you ever passing your driver's test. I got all these other things on here about you passing this in this school, but did you ever pass your driver's test?
At that time, they didn't call it.
Oh, so you're driving without a driver. Where's the police officer? He's driving without a driver's license. You graduate as a doctor of medicine and surgery in 1950 from the University of Mexico.
Let's bring him up here.
You wanted to be a pediatrician at the Elite Children's Hospital in Mexico, but felt that it may be impossible due to your GPA. So a friend encouraged you to take an intensive course in pediatrics for 6 months. So far he's shaking his head yes, so he agrees with me. After which you applied again for an internship and was accepted in 1951 and graduated in 1953. During your time in school in Mexico, you lived in an apartment with several of your cohorts and other students, and you were so poor you all had to eat at the where the government fed poor people. At the end of 1953, you received a fellowship in pediatrics at the hospital in Rochester, New York. Your English wasn't the best, so the hospital hired a tutor for you so you could learn English. After 1 year, you returned to Mexico by bus so you could see more of the beautiful country of the U.S., where you lived and worked in the town of, can you pronounce that? You remember where you worked?
Which one? That was Minatitlan. Minatitlan, Veracruz.
Okay, as a pediatrician. Thank you, Doc. I didn't take Spanish. It was here you decided to become a surgeon. You had a friend in Chevrolet who helped you to get an internship at Prince George's General Hospital in 1961. 2 years, excuse me? 58, my mistake. See, I'm glad you're here because you know more about your life than I do until you get to Laurel. And 2 years earlier, was it 1959 you got married to your lovely wife? 1959, I got that one right. That's the most important one, right?
Yeah.
In 1959, you married your lovely wife, Janice. Here you received, at the Prince George's General Hospital, you received your internship in residency in surgery. You went on to pass your state boards in Maryland and your specialty boards in surgery and became a member of the American College of Surgeons. In 1965, this is where Laurel really boom, because you come to Laurel to practice, and I think you were with Dr. McSini at the time. And you bought a house on Laurel Ridge Road, where you held your office. And the reason why I know that, because you had operated on my one-year-old son. And Dr. McSini had recommended you, and he said, we can't put this off to go see Dr. Perez. And if you can recall, I don't think, maybe you can, but I remember taking my son up there for, after the surgery, to get a check to make sure everything went right, and you were a little distressed. And I asked you why, and you said, well, your pet had just swallowed something and got it caught in the throat. And I said, well, what did you do for it, Doc? And you said, well, I don't know. I took him over to Dr. Morley's, which is right across the street. And I said, aren't you a surgeon and be able to? No, I don't fool with pets or anybody in my family. You sent him to Dr. Morley. I remember that specifically. And ever since then, I've never forgot that, especially what you've done for my son, because Dr. McSini said we needed that done right away. And it was with your skill that you helped us. And let's see, from 78 to 81, you were a board member of the Laurel Hospital and was chief surgeon until you retired in 2000. Doc, you did not receive these awards or degrees. You earned them the hard way. Your favorite expression was, how do you explain that? It's like a miracle. If I may quote you, sir, life can be difficult, especially for people who are poor, as I was. It is important to recognize that we have to work hard and always have a goal. That is what I did in spite of the roadblock. I found the doors were closed for me, but always found a window and have been very successful in life. And every step along the way, there has been someone who, for whatever reason, pointed the way to me. I think the trick in life is to recognize these opportunities when they come and not be afraid to change, end the quote. Now, since coming to Laurel in 1965, you have touched the hearts of so many citizens by both your skill as a surgeon and your compassion for the families and of those loved ones that you were operating on. Doc, there are two words in the English language you do not use together, and that's cannot. But separate these words, we can get what you stand for. I can achieve anything in life and not be afraid to try. So, Doc, congratulations.
Thank you.
You had touched many citizens and saved many lives in Laurel, and Laurel I'm very proud of you coming to our city. So we really appreciate it. So at this time, we're going to let the Chancellor Commander present him with his award.
It is my honor and privilege, sir, to award you and give you an outstanding citizen's award. Fraternal Lodge, number 155, Knights of Pythias, outstanding citizen award, presented to Dr. Felix Flores. His loyalty places him in high esteem for the dedicated service rendered to the citizen of Laurel. Therefore, the award is gratefully presented on behalf of the Laurel Lodge, number 155, Knights of Pythias, given under my hand the 28th day of October 2015. Thank you so much for your service. At this moment, I would like to ask Brother Bill Wolford to come to the podium.
Congratulations, Doc.
Thank you.
And it is a great honor. It is great to honor Dr. Flores tonight, and he has truly done so much and is very deserving of this recognition. Most people know that behind anyone that has accomplished so much, there must be someone that is their driving force, their strength, and their pillar to lean on. As the doctor faced each day of challenges and hard work, he was comforted by the love and caring of his family. His wife, Janice, is also deserving of much recognition. So we would like to present you with this bouquet of flowers and some tickets to Toby's Dinner Theater for you and some friends.
Thank you.
Sure. So thank you, Dr. and Mrs. Perez.
Say a few words.
I got one more question to Dr. Perez. retired since?
2000.
2000. We know your skill as a surgeon might have, you know, flattened up a little bit, and your knowledge of the parts of the body and everything might be a little fuzzy, but I'm not. But we would like to present you with a little gift that will help to increase and enhance your skills again, also to tell you where in the body you can find them. So at this time, I'd like to present you with this little operation game. And you and your lovely wife can work one of
the skill sharp in case you ever call on the fly. Thank you very much for honoring me. All I can tell you that it has been a blessing, and I would call it like a miracle. Coming from Mexico, being very poor, and coming to this country and finding out that this is the country's opportunity. Foreign doctors like me, thousands of doctors came to this country because we knew that this country has the best medicine in the world. And also, this was the best country in the world. So, to me, it was just like a dream because I was a pediatrician. When I finished medical school, I wanted to be a pediatrician, but my education was very difficult because my father was very poor and I didn't find the books, didn't have the money to buy the books. But I had great parents and encouraged me to get the education and work very hard. That's what I did. So when I finished medical school, I wanted to be a pediatrician. And the Children's Hospital in Mexico was the top hospital in Latin America. But it always close to me because they only admitted the top students, and I was not a top student. I was an average student because of the lack of money to buy my books. But on the third year of medical school, I got a part-time job in a pharmaceutical company, and with that money, I was able to buy the books, and my grades went up, but still, I was not a top student. So the doors were closed in that hospital for me because I was an average student. Only a top student would be admitted there. But a friend of mine, just like I have called miracles in my life, this friend of mine was a pediatrician, said, take a 6 months postgraduate course in the hospital. After that, put your application. Maybe you can be admitted. Well, at the end of 6 months, I learned a lot and received a telegram when I went to my hometown, received a telegram and said, you have been admitted to the hospital, but you have to tell us you are single because we don't admit married people. So fortunately, I was single at that time. So then we were 21 interns in the first year and 21 in 2 years because it was 2 years training. The training was amazing in that hospital. So at the end of the 2 years, the director of the hospital will choose one of the interns to send it to Rochester, New York for a fellowship in pediatrics. And I never dreamed I was going to be the one, but I still don't understand why he called me and he said, Felix, do you want to go to Rochester for fellowship? I couldn't believe it. But I came to this country in 1953, and it was just unbelievable. I learned how to love this country. And when I went back to Mexico, I worked 4 years as a pediatrician. But I was frustrated because I couldn't solve the surgical problems of my patients in children. So I wanted to do the surgical training, but in Mexico, there was not an opening at that time. But another miracle, I had a friend of mine here doing the surgical residency in the Prince George's Hospital, and he said, you know, the training is 1 year internship, 4 years of surgical residency, and on the third year, they will send him to Children's Hospital in Washington to do surgery there. To me, it was just like a dream. I couldn't believe it, so I said, would that be any opening for me? So I sent my papers, and in the same week, he answered, and he said, you have been admitted for your training here. So another miracle. So I came here. On the third year, I went to Children's Hospital, and I did a lot of surgery there, and I loved this country. And then I met her, I was doing my internship because she came from Mercy Hospital as a nurse, and I couldn't believe that she'll be interested in a foreign doctor, you know, but she was so beautiful. So anyway, that's what I feel that has been a blessing for me to be able to come to this country and be successful in my practice. And that's what I appreciate this country very much, because I was more successful in this country than I could have been in Mexico because of the system in this country. In this country, you get an education, work hard, and you can be successful in life. So, but I give most of the credit to my parents, because my parents were amazing, wonderful, even though they were very poor. But still, they always encouraged me, and that's my life.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Flores, on behalf of the city of Laurel and the citizens and the council here, and I'm sure speaking for the mayor, I want to congratulate you on your years. You know, we're fighting very hard to save our hospital, so we may have to call you back. So I want you to be aware of that.
I can't believe it. Dr. Mazzini would not believe it.
I don't believe it either.
Dr. Mazzini has not worked very hard to build this hospital. When this hospital was open, I stopped going to the other hospital because this hospital was great. And the patients had the best care. It was just an ideal practice for me, practicing in a lot of hospitals. I got everything I needed. My patients got great care. So I don't understand what's happening.
Well, we're fighting very hard to see that it stays here. I'm going to invite you and the rest of the Knights of Pythias and your wife, lovely wife, who does well at our church all the time, to come up here and use this as a photo place. If you'd like to come up here. Okay, we'll bring him forward. So, if you want to take your raincoat off and come up here for an official, and we'll do a shot with the council as well. As you all have heard, that Dr. Flores certainly represents a great part of our community that we so respect, and we honor him here tonight. Thank you. With that, we'll move on to the general public hearing, and at this time, I'll call We've done the Knights of Pythias, so we'll go on to item number 8, and I'll read that in for the record. I'll close the general public hearing at 7:32. So this is the item number 8, the fourth public hearing with possible action on ordinance number 1848. An ordinance to approve the Revitalization Overlay Area Number 1 Conceptual Plan for the Laurel Shopping Center Development with conditions and providing for an effective date. And with that, Mr. Brock.
Yes, Mr. President. Revitalization Overlay Application Number RO1-1-2015 was filed on April 1st, 2015 by Federal Realty Investment Trust, 50 East Waynewood Road, Suite 200, Waynewood Road, Pennsylvania, 19096, requesting approval of a revitalization overlay concept plan to demolish a portion of the existing shopping center and construct a multifamily apartment complex of up to 180 dwelling units and approximately 100 parking spaces. A parking waiver to lower the number of required parking spaces is also requested. The property is zoned CSH Commercial Shopping Center. On April the 3rd, 2015, a copy of the application and a letter asking for comments was sent to the City of Laurel Department of Parks and Planning, Parks and Recreation, Department of Public Works, Laurel Police Department, City of Laurel Fire Marshal's Office, Maryland State Highway Administration, Washington Suburban Sanitation Commission, Prince George's County Health Department, Prince George's County Department of Public Works and Transportation, Verizon, Prince George's County Public Schools, Prince George's County's Council Member Mary A. Lehman, Maryland Department of Planning, Baltimore Gas and Electric, Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission, Prince George's County Public Schools, Public Accounting and School Boundaries, and the Clerk of the Council for Prince George's County. Responses were received from the following agencies. City of Laurel Police Department, dated April 14, 2015. City of Laurel Office of the Fire Marshal, dated April 14, 2015. City of Laurel Department of Parks and Recreation, April 14, 2015. WSSC, April 20th, 2015. City of Laurel Department of Public Works, April 24th, 2015. Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission, April 28th, 2015. City of Laurel Department of Public Works, August 27, 2015. City of Laurel Department of Public Works, revised September 22nd, 2015. Under date of April 13, 2015, a letter advising of public hearing dates was sent by certified mail to the applicant, the property owner, and all contiguous property owners. All return receipts were received with the exception of three letters, which have been made a part of the official record. The introduction and first public hearing of the mayor and city council regarding the application was held on May 11, 2015. The Planning Commission heard the request at their May 12, 2015 meeting. The file contains a memorandum from the City of Laurel Planning Commission to the Mayor and City Council dated May 13, 2015, and reads as follows. At the regular meeting of the City of Laurel Planning Commission held on May 12, 2015, the following action was taken on the subject zoning application. Mr. Wilson made a motion that the Planning Commission table the application until a further meeting dated to be determined by the Chairwoman Bettman became because the Planning Commission requested more information regarding the proposed project. Mrs. Holland seconded the motion. Roll call continued with all members present voting in favor of the motion. The file contains a certificate of publication verifying that this application and public hearing of May 27, 2015 was advertised in the May 14, 2015 and May 21, 2015 editions of the Prince George's Sentinel. On May 27, 2015, the Mayor and City Council tabled the application pending a recommendation from the Planning Commission. Under date of August 27, 2015, a letter advising of the public hearing dates of September 15, 2015 and September 28, 2015 was sent by certified mail to the applicant. the property owner, and all contiguous property owners. All returns receipts were received with the exception of one letter, which has been made a part of the official record. The Planning Commission heard the request at their September 15th, 2015 meeting. File contains a memorandum from the City of Laurel Planning Commission to the Mayor and City Council dated September 16th, 2015 and reads as follows. Mr. Wilson made a motion that the Planning Commission table the application until the applicant had at least the following items decided upon and worked through with staff before returning to the commission. Number one, determine whether or not the landscape island would be removed within the center to allow direct vehicular connectivity to occur within Montrose Avenue between US Route 1 and 4th Street. Number two, determine whether or not the access change on US Route 1 by removing the northbound teardrop to construct a double left turn lane into the center at US Route 1 and Montrose Avenue intersections will or will not be planned. The City of Laurel Department of Public Works either accept or reject the applicant's traffic study prepared by Linhart Traffic Consultants, Inc. And number four, a plan regarding creating a safe area for mass transit buses to pull over and pick up or discharge passengers is agreed upon between staff and the applicant. Mr. Williford, second the motion. Roll call continue with all members present voting in favor of the motion. The file contains a certificate of publication verifying that this application and public hearing of September 28, 2015 was advertised in the September 10, 2015 and September 17, 2015 editions of the Prince George's Sentinel. On September the 28th, 2015, the Mayor and City Council tabled the applicant pending a recommendation from the Planning Commission. Under date of September 30th, 2015, a letter advising of the public hearing dates of October 20th and October 26th, 2015 was sent by certified mail to the applicant, the property owners, and all contiguous property owners. All return receipts were received with the exception of one letter, which has been made a part of the official record. Under date of October 13th, 2015, a letter advising of a change in the public hearing dates of the Mayor and City Council from October the 26th to October the 28th, 2015 was sent by certified mail to all contiguous property owners. All returns receipt were received with the exception of two letters, which has been made a part of the official record. The Planning Commission heard the request again at their October 20th, 2015 meeting. The file contains a memorandum from the City of Laurel Planning Commission to the Mayor and City Council dated October 21st, 2015 and reads as follows. At the regular meeting of the City of Laurel Planning Commission held on October 20th, 2015, the following action was taken on the subject of zoning application. Mr. Wilson made a motion that the Planning Commission recommend approval of the application to the Mayor and City Council as presented with the conditions listed in the technical staff report and that the applicant has agreed that the landscape island along Montrose Avenues between US 1 and 4th Street will not be removed at this time. However, the recommendation to approve does not preclude the applicant from applying for an amendment to remove the island in some future date. Mr. Williford, second the motion. Roll call continue with all members present voting in favor of the motion. The file contains a certificate of publication verifying that this application and public hearing of October 28, 2015 was advertised in the October 15th and October the 22nd, 2015 edition of the Prince George's Sentinel. The file contains an affidavit signed by the applicant attesting that a zoning sign has been placed on the subject property and has remained and shall remain until a decision is reached by the Mayor and City Council. That concludes the reading of the file, Mr. President.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Mr. Gibbs.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, and members of the council, and Mr. Gibbs, attorney with offices in Largo.
You turn the mic on, Mr. Gibbs. Push it, it'll go green.
Yeah.
There you go.
There it is. You got it.
You got it.
Nope.
I am left-handed. Yeah. And so,
I was going to take exception to your earlier comment that left-handers start out disadvantaged in life, but perhaps you're right.
You're fine.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here this evening. Simply want to recognize Mr. Brian Donnelly behind me to my left, your right, who is responsible for all federal real estate Federal Realty Investment Trust activities in the Mid-Atlantic region, and certainly this property is a part of his responsibility. And of course, our consultants, Mr. Speech from the civil engineering firm of Bowler Engineering and Mr. Lenhart, representing his own company, are both here this evening as well. It's been a long time to get here. You know, we've been before you previously. We've been before the Planning Commission on a couple of different occasions. We're happy that we're here tonight at 1 with your staff, with the Planning Commission. We have no objection to any of the conditions which have been recommended to be attached to the approval of this overlay. And I'll be happy to respond to any questions. I did want to reemphasize again that we were informed that there was a consensus within the city that the island on Montrose should not be removed at this time. We pointed out to the Planning Commission that we did want to reserve the opportunity to come back and speak with the city at some future time, potentially. Not that we necessarily will, but we didn't want that comment to be taken as a unilateral proclamation on the part of Federal Realty that there would never be any desire to discuss that option in the future. So with that having been said, again, I'll be happy to answer any questions that you might have. And thanks once again to your staff for all the time they spent working with us, and to the Planning Commission for working with us, and you for entertaining the application. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gibbs. For the record, I received a request from the administration to poll the council individually without a quorum, and to feel what we felt it would be necessary, if anything, to take that island out. And we all felt, I think it's fair to say, that island should stay at this particular time because of public safety issues.
Right. And I understand that comment. Thank you.
Any comments from the council or questions?
Mr. President,
yes.
I do have a question for Mr. Brock. Mr. Brock, if you would, in your report, you mentioned just one condition that the commission voted on. Could you just give, at least for my own information, the list of conditions that were voted upon by the Planning Commission?
The four conditions that the Planning Commission tabled this item for, in order to work with staff and bring it back to the next Planning Commission, was first the landscape island, whether it would be removed or not, and the decision was to maintain it as it currently stands. The second item was to determine whether or not the access change on US 1 by removing the northbound teardrop to construct a left turn into the center will or will not be planned. That depends on whether the applicant receives a TIF or not from the mayor and the city council. The City of Laurel Department of Public Works either reject or accept the traffic study prepared by Lynn Hart Traffic Consultants, Inc. The Public Works Department rejected their numbers in favor of the numbers they had done themselves. And the fourth, regarding a safe area for mass transit, this is one of the conditions that the applicant has agreed to have a bus pull off between the town center and the shopping center on the east side of the road, which will allow the bus to be pulled off and in a safe manner for boarding and disembarking customers.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that those conditions were part of the record for this meeting as well.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Anything else, Mr. Gibbs?
No, only to mention that there is, I think, a staff exhibit which illustrates the bus pull-off area that we have agreed to. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions from the council? If not, I'll take a motion.
Mr. President?
Yes, sir.
I'll move for the approval of ordinance number 1848, an ordinance to approve the Revitalization Overlay Area number 1 conceptual plan for Laurel Shopping Center Development with conditions and providing an effective date.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Smalls. Madam Clerk?
Mr. Les?
Yes.
Mr. Smalls?
I vote yes.
Ms. Nicholas?
Yes.
Ms. Crary?
Yes.
President Ricks?
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Have a nice evening.
Appreciate it. Item number 9, that's the second public hearing with possible action on ordinance number 1853. An ordinance to approve the Revitalization Overlay Area Number 1 Conceptual Site Plan for Hawthorne Place Development with conditions and providing an effective date. And for that, we have Mr. Ship. Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Proctor.
Yes, Mr. President. Revitalization Overlay Application Number RO1-1-2015 was filed on April 1st, 2015 by Federal Realty Investment Trust, 50 East Waynewood Road, Suite 200. Right. Waynewood, Pennsylvania, 19096, requesting approval of revitalization. Am I on the correct one? Sorry, too many pieces of paper. Revitalization Overlay Application Number RO1-2-2015 was filed on July 28, 2015 by CS Hawthorne LLC, 1701 Rockville Pike, Suite B20, Rockville, Maryland, 20852, requesting reapproval of a revitalization overlay concept plan to demolish the existing 55,000 square foot trucking terminal and redevelop the site to include 1,071 multifamily units, later changed to the original request of 1,006 units, 1,466 on-site parking spaces, and community amenities. The original concept plan was approved in 2007 and the final plan was approved in 2008. However, construction did not begin within the 5-year time span, so the approval expired and requires reapproval. The property is zoned IG Industrial General. On August the 13th, 2015, a copy of the application and a letter asking for comments was sent to the City of Laurel Department of Parks and Recreation, Department of Public Works, Laurel Police Department, City of Laurel Fire Marshal's Office, Maryland State Highway Administration, Washington Suburban Sanitation Commission, Prince George's County Health Department, Prince George's County Department of Public Works and Transportation, Verizon, Prince George's County Public School, Prince George's County Council Member Mary A. Lehman, Maryland Department of Planning, Baltimore Gas and Electric, Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission, Prince George's County Public Schools, Public Accounting and School Boundaries, and the Clerk of the County of the Council for Prince George's County. Responses were received from the following agencies: City of Laurel Office of the Fire Marshal, August 13, 2015. City of Laurel Police Department, August 24, 2015. WSSC, September 3, 2015. City of Laurel Department of Public Works, September 8, 2015. City of Laurel Department of Parks and Recreation, September 11, 2015. Under date of August 17, 2015, a letter advising of public hearing dates of September 9th, 14th, 15th, and 28th, 2015 was sent by certified mail to the applicant, the property owner, and all contiguous property owners. All return receipts were received. Under date of August 31st, 2015, a letter advising of the changes to the applicant application and noting that the hearing dates remain unchanged from September 20th, 15 was sent by regular mail to all contiguous property owners. The file contains a certification of publication verifying that this application and public hearing of September 28, 2015 was advertised in the September 10, 2015 edition of Prince George's Sentinel. The introduction and first public hearing of the Mayor and City Council regarding the application was held on September 14, 2015. At the applicant's request, the application was removed from the September 15, 2015 Planning Commission and September 28, 2015 Mayor and City Council agenda. They're dated September 25th, 2015. A letter advising of the public hearing dates of October 14th, October 20th, and October 26, 2015 was sent by certified mail to the applicant and the property owners and all contiguous property owners. All return receipts were received. Under date of October 13, 2015, a letter advising of a change in the public hearing date of the mayor and city council from October the 26th to October the 28th, 2015 was sent by certified mail to all contiguous property owners. All return receipts were received with the exception of one letter, which has been made part of the official record. The Planning Commission heard the request at their October 20, 2015 meeting. The file contains a memorandum from the City of Laurel Planning Commission to the Mayor and City Council dated October 21st, 2015, reads as follows. At the regular meeting of the City of Laurel Planning Commission held on October 20th, 2015, the following action was taken on the subject zoning application. On motion by Mr. Wilson, seconded by Mr. Welliford, and carried on a roll call vote of all members present, the Planning Commission recommended that the Mayor and City Council approve Revitalization Overlay Concept Plan RO1-2-2015, Ordinance Number 1853 as presented. The file contains a certification of publication verifying that the application and the public hearing of October 28th, 2015 was advertised, and the October 15th, 2015 and October 22nd, 2015 edition of the Prince George's Sentinel. The file contains an affidavit signed by the applicant attesting that a zoning sign has been placed on the subject property and has remained and shall remain until a decision is reached by the mayor and city council. That concludes the reading of the file, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Brock. Mr. Shipp, now the general public hearing is 7:54.
There is one change that needs to be made. The technical staff report was presented as evidence to the ordinance. There are two conditions that are contained within the staff report that need to be deleted, which is item number 33, the police impact for development requires 7 new officers, and the applicant shall make a one-time payment of city to the city in the amount of $97,944. These two fees are going to be included in the impact fees that the applicant will be paying at the time that he draws his building permits. So these two conditions will be met otherwise in the staff report.
Mr. Chip, you acknowledge those, sir? Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Go ahead, sir. I'm sorry. Oh, the mic.
There it is.
Got it.
I think it's the lawyers that are challenged. Other folks didn't have a problem. Thank you, Mr. Council President, members of the council. It's a pleasure to be here at this point where we're hopeful that we would get a final approval of our initial application to recertify this plan. It was sometime in July, I believe, when I was contacted by Mr. Manzi. We were trying to verify the status of the property, and it one of those uncomfortable phone calls when Bob had to call me up and tell me, we got a little problem here because of the five-year rule. And I mentioned that just to say that, you know, once we got through that phone call, as Bob and I always do, we rolled up our sleeves and talked about how to address it. And then your staff took it from there. And it's been nothing but a positive cooperative effort with your staff, the city staff, Planning Commission and with this council, and we very much appreciate it. My client, Mr. Cohen, has, I think, tried to honor the original commitment and improve a little bit, and one of the major improvements was bringing that swimming pool from phase two into phase one, which I think is a big addition to the project at the outset. And your staff in the city has upheld their end of the bargain and has gotten us through the process quickly and fairly, and we very much appreciate your help and support to get us to where we are today. And we're here to answer any questions, but hopeful to get on to the next
one day. Thing I'd like to do, sir, just because your microphone was off, and ask you the question again, do you acknowledge the two requests that the staff has made that we have to deal with tonight?
Yes, and that was a request that our discussion that we had at the last meeting, and your staff has helped us coordinate that, and we agree with Mr. Brock's.
Fine, thank you very much. Does the council have any further questions to ask to Mr. Schiff? Seeing none, thank you very much, sir. I appreciate it. Council, I'll close the public general public hearing on this issue at 7:57. What's the pleasure of the council?
Mr. President.
Yes, Ms. Query.
I recommend that we approve the revitalization overlay RO1-2, 2015.
Thank you. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Les. Madam Clerk?
Ms. Query?
Yes.
Mr. Les?
Yes.
Ms. Nicholas?
Yes.
Mr. Smalls?
I would just like once again to encourage the applicant as well as our staff to encourage the hiring of local minority and women-owned businesses to assist in supporting this project. And I vote yes.
President Ricks.
And I would also like to remind you all that we are dealing with a very difficult situation with the railroad station. And I'm hoping that a lot of your people in that development, and this may be a little premature, but nevertheless, I want you to be mindful of the fact that we're trying to deal with this issue. And as you go forward and deal with the TOD, I hope that we're able to work out some good deals with you to get transportation for your clients between that quarter mile distance between the station. And so with that, yes, for me. Thank you. Anything else to come before the council? Seeing none, we stand adjourned.